I think it's the light of God that shines in a nation's darkness. It's the love of God that breaks through a nation's dullness. And it's the life of God that flows through our nation's deadness. Prayer is the key concerning America's revival, folks. We need to be a nation of people that are more interested in the person of God than personal gold. More consumed in God's righteousness than getting rich, and more determined to achieve special victories than acquiring personal vices. God's victories, folks. If we continue in prayer, I truly believe, we will have revival in this nation. We must commit to purity, each and every one of us, and turn away from our wicked ways. There's a phrase in the New Testament that is only one word. That one word is repentance. Repentance is key as well. Psalm 66:18 says, "If I regard sin in my heart, the Lord will not hear me." As Isaiah 59:2 says, "Your sins have hidden his face from you, so he cannot hear you." 1 John 1:9, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." So let's take a look at our own lives and ask, how are we doing? How are we doing personally? If we commit to purity in our lives, we will have revival, folks. And last of all, a good friend of mine reminded me of this today. We must proclaim his promise. "Then I will hear their prayers, forgive their sins, and heal their land." That is a promise from God. He says, "I will hear their prayers, forgive their sins, and heal their land." Think about what's happening in the Gulf right now, folks. If enough of us prayed hard enough and truly felt it, believed it, knew it with all that we were, and put our faith in our Father, that wouldn't be an issue for us. There's something that blows my mind when I think about it. And that's that God wants to send real revival more than we want to receive it. You ever thought about that? He wants to give us revival. He wants to answer our prayers. He wants to fulfill those promises. But we have to want to receive it first. Here are some of God's revival promises he's made. You can find this throughout Scripture. We will receive his favor in that he will hear from heaven. He will hear us. We will receive his forgiveness. He says he'll forgive our sins. We will receive his fruitfulness. He did say he would heal our land. God is always saying to America, "I will heal any part of your society if society will just let me heal them." So he wants to take care of us. He wants to heal us. He wants to come into our lives, but we must be there and must be willing to accept him. I ask you guys tonight, what good is it if our 401k is sour in value? What good is it if every home has 2 Mercedes-Benz in the garage? What good is it if every wrist has a Rolex watch? And what good is it if we tucked in our Calvin Klein jeans? What good is it if we all have Michael Jordan tennis shoes? I think there's a new brand now. What good is it if our homes have no favor with God and our lives have no forgiveness from Jesus? And our daily walk has no fruitfulness in spirit. It's a good question, right? We could have all the things in the world, but if we don't have Jesus Christ in our hearts and in our lives, then it's all for nothing. Everything that you have here, I'm looking around my living room right now because I'm able to sit in my living room tonight because I'm using Skype, and I'm thinking it's a little bit clearer than before. I'm looking around my room and all the things that I have. I could take them out and give them all away tomorrow, and that'd be all right with me. It's almost a freeing thing, giving up, you know, satellite TV and giving up everything here. It's less bills I got to pay, especially since money's running low, right? So it's a freeing experience for all of us. Our first president of the United States of America, George Washington, said some things, and he said them very well. He said, I know how I now make my prayer that God would keep you, the leaders of this new nation, in his holy protection, that he would incline the hearts of the citizens to be obedient to government, to entertain a brotherly love for one another, and finally that he would most graciously be pleased to have us show love, mercy, charity, and most of all, humility, and that he would make us to be temperament of mind, having the characteristics of the divine author of our blessed nation, without which we shall never hope to be a happy nation. Folks, where has the happiness gone? I'm seeing it all over the news and in my neighbors and the people that live with me. Where has all the happiness gone? I remember those days. As Almighty God has been eliminated from public view, so has the happiness that was once prevalent in this great nation. You remove God from the equation, and there goes your happiness as well. In the second sentence of the Declaration of Independence, and I'm sure you all know it, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Right now, this very night, millions of people have lost their jobs. The homes of many have been foreclosed upon. The economy right now is in shambles. Morality has all but disappeared from our culture. People are committing suicide at an amazing rate. We have become self-centered, selfish, materialistic people, and our current government is no longer of the people, by the people, and for the people. The current governmental administration has systematically circumvented the Constitution of the United States, folks. All those appointed czars, they've been deliberate. That was a deliberate thing. That was so that they could withhold accountability to the people. No oversight, no advice, and consent of Congress. Everything today is a crisis and a rush to pass laws that are leading straight to socialism. And the loss of our freedom is ever ongoing. We have been deceived, folks, and it hurts. An administration that professed transparency and openness during the campaign has been anything but that. Congress is now passing laws without even reading them. And why? Why? Because they're overwhelmed with documents that cannot be read in a short time between the time they get it and then by the time it's time to vote on them. The current administration has engaged in the biggest seizure of power in the history of the United States of America. And we're being taxed without representation, and that causes the Tea Party to be resignated. Ladies and gentlemen, America has packed her own lunch, and now we're being force-fed. And it is sticking to the roof of our mouth, and we need something to wash it down, but it is too hard to swallow. We want to change, and we're giving it. We reap what we sow. Now remember, sin leads to death, and nations are certainly not exempt from that law. The whole universe is against the man who is against God, so we need to make sure we are on his side. Who is on the Lord's side in this country? Success is finding out which way God is moving and getting on board. If you don't, well, you're likely to have a few head-on collisions that you probably won't like. If you just take a look at history, study the history of all the great civilizations in the past. Once they made a decision to fight against God and his way, they were doomed. Let's take Egypt. Pharaoh couldn't stand against God, but the heavens fought against him and his whole army was drowned in the Red Sea. And how about the Babylonian Empire? Their walls were so thick that they say three chariots could race along the walls. But they were arrogant people.